celebrate a glorious occasion with Lindsay and Andrew. We welcome you to Southmore Church. I am a guest here thanks to the ministers who normally serve here. And as some of you may recognize, I'm not a native Jordan. No problem there. But we meet together in the presence of God to witness together the marriage of Andrew and Lindsay, to ask God's blessing upon them, to support them with our prayers, and to share in their joy. Let us begin then by celebrating, singing together, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Forgive and renew us. Fill us with your Spirit.
that in true thankfulness we may bear witness to your love through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
There are some thoughts on love and marriage which are given to us in our Methodist service, and I share those with you at this time. Lindsay and Andrew, with your families and friends, we thank God for this day, for the gift of marriage. It is the will of God that in marriage, husband and wife should experience a lifelong unity of heart, body, and mind, comfort and companionship, enrichment, encouragement, tenderness, and trust. It is the will of God that marriage should be honored as a way of life in which we may know the security of love and care and grow towards maturity. Through such marriage, children may be nurtured, family life strengthened, and human society enriched. No one should enter marriage lightly or selfishly, for marriage involves the giving of a woman and a man wholeheartedly to each other. Christ, in his self-giving, comes to our help, for he loves us and gave himself for us. Andrew and Lindsay, you are now to share this way of life, which God has created and in Christ has blessed. Today we pray that the Holy Spirit will guide and strengthen you, and that you may fulfill God's purposes for the rest of your lives. And now Andrew and Lindsay are to make their declarations, which the law requires. Are you, Andrew Richard Wallace, free lawfully to marry Lindsay Telford? Are you, Lindsay Telford, free lawfully to marry Andrew Richard Wallace? You have made the declarations required by law. I ask you now to affirm in the presence of all your intention to marry each other. Andrew, are you willing to give yourself in marriage to Lindsay?
Yeah.
And will you love her, comfort, honor her, be her companion through all the joys and sorrows of life, and be faithful to her as long as you both shall live?
With God's help, I will.
And Lindsay, are you willing to give yourself in marriage to Andrew? And will you love him, comfort him, honor him, keep him, being his companion through all the joys and sorrows of life, and be faithful to him as long as you both shall live? This point, Chris, if you would do the reading from Paul's letter to the Philippians.
Rejoice in the Lord always, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in anything, be prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you.
A wonderful guideline for life in general, but especially now, for our two people here, Andrew and Lindsay. I have the opportunity now to say a few words. Customarily, I'm 45 minutes, so relax. No, not really. I'm not really that. But I do have some thoughts on marriage, having been involved in marriage a long time. And these are some thoughts that I have. First of all, it is not a contract. It is a covenant. Not a contract, it's a covenant. In a contract, you just simply, as long as the other person holds up their end of the bargain, then you hold up yours. And as soon as someone gets out of line with his contract, you don't have any more responsibility. But in a covenant, you're drawn together. You make a commitment which is regardless of what the other person does. You're making a plan to live out a relationship in that sort of complete and exclusive way. That means that marriage is not a 50-50 agreement. You know, I've had people come to me and say, well, she or he is not living up to his or her half of the bargain. And so people think sometimes it's a 50-50 thing. You get 50%, you get 50%. Doesn't work that way. There are times when you give 100%. And the other person at times gives 100%. And you are negotiable and flexible in life in that way. Paul has said to us in another passage, be slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Ah, yes, that helps. To be slow to anger. Now, this is a lesson that I learned slowly because I'm not very good at patience. But patience is an important part of a relationship. Honor is an important part. And commitment. There was a time when Paul Newman, the actor, was interviewed because he had been married so long to Joan Woodard, and all around them, people were divorcing in Hollywood. And they asked him, what is it that makes your marriage relationship different that you last so long? And he said, commitment. Commitment. The fact of having made our decision and we go with it. Well, there's one more thing, and that is humor. And that is an important part of marriage. Now, I think sometimes we take ourselves a bit seriously, very seriously, and are kind of that way. But to have a sense of humor is important. And humor about ourselves, because we are so fallible. We can make so many mistakes, and we know that. And so we can laugh at ourselves. And that's an important thing to learn. One last thing, just a little bit about Jesus. Because some of you may know that the very first miracle that Jesus performed was when he turned water into wine, which incidentally proves that he was not a Methodist. But never mind. He turned water into wine at the wedding feast. And that was his first miracle. And his miracle has continued through the ages as people have married in the church before the altar of God and the cross of Jesus and have said their vows one to the other and have made their commitment to live together well. And so I join with all of your friends here in wishing you the very best of happiness, a long life together, and a life with great joy and great commitment and sense of God's presence with you. Now let us join in singing our second hymn. This song, Jerusalem, actually has a very powerful meaning for us. It was written a long time ago, 1804, but really came to life when Britain was feeling down in 1914. Hubert Parry wrote the music that we're about to sing, and we began to sing this. It has since become a very strong mark of our confidence that God is with us. So let us sing together. And he did these feats in ancient times.
Thank you.
wedding ring is an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual being, uniting together Andrew and Lindsay in holy love. Let us pray. Eternal God, bless these rings, that they may be the symbols of love and trust between Lindsay and Andrew. I give you this ring, as a sign of our marriage. With my body I honor you. All that I am I give to you.
All that I am I give to you.
And all that I have I share with you.
And all that I have I share with you.
Within the love of God.
Within the love of God.
Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
I give you this ring. As a sign of our marriage. With my body I honor you. All that I am I give to you. And all that I have I share with you. Within the love of God. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Before God, and in the presence of us all, Andrew and Lindsay have exchanged vows, have joined hands, have given and received rings, binding themselves each to the other in the covenant of marriage. We therefore proclaim that they are now husband and wife together. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And let all God's people say, Amen.
Amen.
And now may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. May God be your protection and your wisdom, your guide and your peace, and your joy, and your comfort, and your eternal rest. Amen.
Amen.
And now, let us join together in prayer. God of grace, source of all love, we pray for Lindsay and Andrew, that they may live together in love and faithfulness to the end of their lives. Enrich their friendship, that each may be for the other a companion in joy and a comfort in sorrow. Help Andrew and Lindsay to be patient, gentle, full of humor, forgiving, that their marriage may reflect Christ's love for all people. Enable them to make their home a place of welcome and friendship, that their life together may be a source of strength and joy to others. And may we, who have witnessed these vows today, be signs of your love to the world. All this we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us when we pray to say together,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace now and evermore.
Amen.
We now join in singing our closing hymn, O Perfect Love, All Human Thought Transcend.
Thank you. Oh, there are some.
So they're round about.
Extreme. Can only get it at the traffic lights right in the middle of Durham.
Right.
Out underneath and it's put along by the river.
Right.
They got past the passport office and down underneath.
Thank you.
I'm going to drop off. That'll be something.
Well, this is not when that flies up as well.
Don't say anything inappropriate.
Not at all. Stop.
Once I believed that when love is Mama Cass.
Stars shining bright above you. Night breezes seem to whisper, I love you. Birds singing in the sycamore tree. Dream a little dream of me. Say nighty night and kiss me. Just hold me tight and tell me you'll miss me. While I'm alone and blue as can be. Dream a little dream.
Shared with every one of you, and we thank you all for coming.
I would like to end and ask you to raise your glasses to a toast to the bride and groom. Can I just say one thing? Those of you with a nervous disposition should really leave when the best man speaks. So don't say you haven't been one.
Sorry, Bob and Lee. I say it, Bob. I could call you Andrew, but no one in the room would know who you are. I'd say it, Bob. Sorry. You boys should be bouncers the way you were searching and frisking women on the way to the church there. There's an unwritten wedding etiquette rule that says nobody should look more handsome than the groom. And I'd like to thank the two ushers and best man for speaking a little sick to that boy. I might regret that. Lee, I have to say, when you tried your suit on Sunday, I really thought it was Roddy Trotter coming down the stairs. Thanks to both for doing an excellent job. Speaking of the best man, I'd like to thank Christopher for agreeing to be mine. I have to say the best man and ushers have done a fantastic job in organising the stag do in the tranquil resort of Benidorm and Spain. Thanks also to all the lads for, if I'm honest, just abusing us for 3 days. I'll not go too much into that because no doubt will be the theme of the best man speech. But safe to say everyone had a good time. Also, thanks to Christopher for doing the wonderful reading in the chapel earlier. When we met David to plan the wedding, I couldn't resist walking into that one. Thanks also to Christopher and Rebecca for arranging the entertainment tonight. I had to get that one in just in case it's rubbish, you know what I mean. Stephen, thanks for your hospitality last night. Not the best experience sharing a bed with you. I don't know how you managed, Kira. Good breakfast, though. Jackie, thanks for doing the photos today and all of your patience in organising us. Bridesmaids, thanks to the three bridesmaids, Sarah, Rebecca and Sophie, who I'm sure you'll all agree look stunning today. Over the last few months and obviously today, and for ensuring Lindsay was ready and at the chapel on time, which is a miracle in itself. So if you can all be understanding, again, please raise a toast to the bridesmaids. The bridesmaids. Finally, I would like to thank my wife, Lindsay. Today, it really would not have been the same without you. Seriously, though.
Seriously.
Thank you for agreeing to marry me and making me the happiest man in the world. Whoa. To see you walking down the aisle earlier, I was absolutely speechless. The last year, you put a great deal of planning into today, and we talked nothing else but weddings. So we'll have to find something else to occupy our time, starting with the honeymoon on Tuesday, where I think we both deserve a relaxing couple of weeks. Right, I'm now going to hand you over to the best man. So before I sit down, cringe at the lot of lies he's going to tell you, I would like to thank everyone again for coming. Hope you enjoy the rest of the afternoon and the evening. And the Bolton Wanderers team were in here, and they were watching the videos because they were playing the Dirty Maggots the next day. So, now they've got a voice. So, what I found out at the time was that we were peering through the windows and Nigel Riacocca was getting a full body arm massage on George Wallace's table there. And I was just taking the covers like, because he looked. And for this side of the room, all of you that don't know me, I like pint of lager with a little touch of lime. I was nervous when I was asked to do this speech. I wasn't bothered about writing it. I wasn't really bothered. It was the performing that was doing it. So, in the job I do, I've always thought that practice makes perfect. But I couldn't really read my speech out in the job I do. I get sacked. So what I decided to do was to go to Lindsay's work. And I decided to read it out to everybody at Lindsay's work. And if anybody that doesn't know where Lindsay's work, it's an old people's home. When I was walking up to the room, I had a massive smile on my face because they all seemed like they pissed themselves. I don't know if this is a common tradition that the best man speak shouldn't really last as long as the... You're up. But the groom can make love for. And to be honest, I'm probably very pap up now. Right, now for the serious part, I would like to start by agreeing with what Andrew said, Bing, as I call him, saying that the bridesmaids were absolutely fantastic today, and I'd like to give them a round of applause. I would also like to thank the two sets of parents, but in particular, I would like to thank Alice and Paul, because 26 years ago, they were sending Lindsay to bed with a dummy, and I'd like to thank them for continuing that tradition in this day. most importantly, I'd like to raise a toast just to how absolutely beautiful the bride looks today. Oh, I've never seen anyone in that. Lindsay.
Lindsay.
Speech I would say probably about 3 months ago, and I was confident with it, I was happy with it. And Andrew's been very quiet because he's usually a wind-up merchant, and he's been quiet for a long period of time. But then I woke up, or I'll say I was woke up at 4:30 in the morning to see a traffic cone on the top of my car. So I was thinking to myself, I'm going to rewrite this speech. So this is why all of the next bit is written. That was going to be nice, but you've got no chance. Also, the first version of the speech when I was writing it, I was reading it out to my good friend Stephen Wallace. It took about 5 minutes to read, and then we had a bit of a discussion that I probably have to slow the way I'm speaking down, really just due to the hard hearing and the Scottish people are taking up six. My dad stole a bit of my thunder here earlier. I don't know if anybody knows this, but the Wallace and Telford bond was actually started by me and Lindsay. And when I was a young lad, around about the age of, I would say, 7, 8 or 9, I can't remember, we decided, me and my friend used to hang about with Lindsay and Claire. Where's Claire? Was it weird? Are you Claire? And it was basically, when you're 9, I don't know anybody that's got sons and daughters, the flirting ritual, I went up 2 years ago, the flirting rituals was more like probably violence and actually loving. And one day we decided, me and my friend, that would be a good idea to chase Lindsay and Claire on the bikes. And I mean, I was only 7. What we didn't know is that women don't really know a lot about mechanics, so they couldn't use brakes. So what Lindsay decided to do was put her front brake on. And yeah, you've guessed it, you know what's happening next. She went flying over the handlebars. Right, I'm not going to tell you the rest of the story because she'll absolutely kill us. But as I said earlier, this side of the room, I like to pipe the log with lime, and my tongue goes a bit loose. No way I'm getting that. Look, there's one thing I've always been a bit confused about, is that I go to Lindsay's house, I go to visit them, and I go out with the pub, and Lindsay always kicks the living daylight out of us. I don't know why. But I'm a bit confused. Is she still carrying on that flirting? Does she actually like kicking the living daylights out of us? I mean, we can have a vote about that later. Hey, that's enough for Lindsay. I don't know if anybody... I don't know if anybody knows this. When I was young, family might know this, that Andrew was insanely jealous. He could turn around. Andrew was insanely jealous of me when I was a younger, handsome brother. And one day when I was in my cup, Andrew actually went in and bit me. Am I right? Yeah. And my parents always assures me that he was the whiniest kid in the world. Ranging through Strops and Marks and Spencers to Strops at home and Strops everywhere. I mean, he was probably only about 20 when that finished. So there's a bit of evidence, really. I mean, as you can see, that Peter Reed in front. That's Andrew at the back. He wasn't obviously happy at the time. Bless him. In our early teens, there's quite a lot of people, especially Lindsay, who back me up. I totally performed different to how Andrew in school. Andrew was a swot. Billy Boyd, if anybody knows him in the room, loved him. I couldn't write, apparently, according to Billy Boyd. And then it got to the point where... No, I can't do it. But as you can see, Andrew was a huge, massive geek. And he was called, he was part of the friendship group that I can only probably describe in the young people's room as being like the in-betweeners. To the old people in the room, they had no street cred. They were horrible. When I was playing football, I was playing cricket, Andrew would be out playing buses. He'd go to the go-ahead or the bus depot at Stanley to watch the buses go through the car wash. He was on the bus. I was never invited. So, if you can imagine, I'm playing football, I'm playing cricket. Andrew was also there at the top of the street, the track shop, with a can of pop in his wheels, pretending his back wheels was an engine. And he also pretended he was stopping at different places, and he was basically driving the bus on the way to Durham via Cyprus. Then one day, everything totally changed. He was playing football with me and a couple of the lads down near Greenland School, and Lindsay was there. I mean, I don't know if anybody noticed, but you can just see by the way he walks, he can't play football, like, he's got two left feet. And Andrew, but it was just basically, he got, all of a sudden, was obsessed. Basically, I'll say it properly, it was a problem, sorry, parted. They all together all the time. And Lindsay changed him. He went from being a geek to actually being a rebel, from playing buses to drink a Blastoise before behind Mickey's glove. For this side of the room, Blastoise, a bit of diamond white with a mixture of fruit-based cocktail in a lager and lime, a pint of lager with a little touch of corn. So Andrew turned into what I'm going to say is a normal standing ad, or whatever that is, I don't think anybody knows. And he started to like football massively. And he's just said before, he's a huge, huge Newcastle United fan. But when he started, he was a bit naive, and as I say, he was a bit of a geek, and he decided to support the unwashed lot over the water. Quite surprised and looking at that now, but you can actually see what Andrew used to be like. I don't know why he's actually so happy, but then I was looking at the picture and I figured out where his hand is. Absolutely brilliant, top of the league, he decided to shift alliances to Newcastle United, which team's the best team in the North East.
Of Newcastle.
Andrew left Stanley School of Technology, the great establishment, in about 1998. And at the time, Lindsay was just starting in year seven. I mean, you can make of that what you want, but in my eyes, a bit dodgy. He went to New College Durham, where he met the other two loves of his life, computing and Andrew Bogart. Since they met at college, they were inseparable. They went to college together, they got, what did you get, two U's and an E, you feel? They then went to university, they did a degree, a top-up degree, then a master's degree, and then got a job together, and used to travel all the way down North Allerton, hand in hand. And he is actually prime suspect number one for the cord on the car. As Andrew got older, his favourite band is what?
ABBA.
Yeah. Andrew's favourite band is ABBA. And his CD collections range from Westlife to the band that probably the old people in the room will know, the Blackpool Bells. He started to get into computers massively, and that's where he works now. But what I want to do is I want to dare anybody in the room to ask, apart from the people at table number six who work with him, actually what he does. Because every time he's told me, I fell asleep halfway through and I haven't got a clue. All I do know is he works from home. He says he does anyway. In his adult years, Andrew's only probably become what I could describe as a bit of a menace. And he likes alcohol, which is not really a good thing for me. No mind. And that's one of the massive many things that Lindsay and Andrew have in common. Over the years, as I said earlier, they were inseparable, and wherever Andrew was, Lindsay was also there at the time, and she could drink more than any of the lads put together. She could probably down a pint of Boddington's in 5 seconds flat, where it takes me probably about a good 10 or 12. Seconds. And as I said earlier, if you go back to the slide then, Andrew's massively lost his hair. And that's a massive huge change over the last couple of years. And what I always find quite hilarious, and there's a few of the lads at the back there, is what he blames it on. He doesn't blame it on the fact that it's nature and he's lost his hair. It apparently is Link shower gel. Apparently there was a lesbian couple in Cancun who confirmed that. Never mind. Him and Lindsay over the years have had plenty of holidays. They go all over the place. They've been to the Caribbean or Egypt about 27 times. Better don't want to see the love. And on one visit away, Andrew asked if he could borrow my brand new iPod. Right? And I said, that's fine. I don't mind you borrow my iPod as long as you don't break it. Yet, guess what? It was broke. Come back, water damaged, he assured me.
Water
damaged. The item was under warranty, so I sent it back and I got a brand new one. I wasn't bothered about that. But what Lindsay told me 2 months ago was quite disturbing. She said basically one night, when he was drunk, he thought his bedside cabinet was the toilet. So I suppose he looked something like that. I'm not saying the song title. Does anybody like to sing along?
Yes.
Is anybody familiar with Off Beatus here? Is anybody familiar with That's Living Alright?
Yeah.
I'll put it on the board so you actually follow the words as well, the people that don't know. We'll start about 3 seconds flat. It will.
4, 5.
Working on a side from morning till night. That's living alright. That's living alright. Then a pint with the boys in a bottle of noise. That's living alright. That's living alright. We're waiting all day for a pickings of
kiss the dames and you don't ask their names, that's living all right.
Stephen Wallace, please.
absolute nightmare when it comes to nights out or going on stag dudes. He's double the menace that he is. But this time it was a bit different. He's in love. Basically, all he went on about for the whole 3 days was the new love of his life, Gaynor. Oh, the American for Gaynor, Gaynor. Then it was up to Andrew, who was absolutely fantastic. We gave him a list of things to do, 10 things, and he'd done it in probably about 2.5 hours flat. And it probably would have took me about 3 days. He had some bottle. I'll never, ever, ever forget the time seeing him and Terry Lee on the double wall. Chicken and Benidorm, and basically with the regulars that could only resemble extras from what food flew over the cuckoo's nest. Two of the things that Andrew needed to do was basically get dressed up. One is Bruno. Fantastic day, and I will see you tonight. Basically, what I'm saying is here is that I'm scared to come because I know maybe it's going to actually rip us to bits, Billy Campbell. He's the second come to compass with Bob for the corn incident. I would like to wish Andrew and Lindsay a fantastic future together. And when you have children, I would love to extend our offer of buying one season ticket and getting 7 free. Your sincerely, Martin O'Neill. I would love to wish Andrew a fantastic future with his new bride, Lindsay. We are so happy that both of you are getting married that we are extending your membership by 1 year free of charge. Yours sincerely, the Love Shack Swimming Swingers Club. It's that. As I have talked a lot, and I could probably talk for another half an hour, but I'm really, really, really hungry because Stephen's breakfast was mingham this morning. I would like to wrap it up. I would like to finish by saying that Lindsay, as echoed by my dad, has been part of our lives for such a long time. She's like a sister to me and a daughter to my parents. If I was to ask anybody in the room, I'm sure you'd agree that we're probably one of the nicest couples they've ever met. Yay. I would like to wish them all the best, same luck as they've had for the last 15 years, as long as you start kicking the living daylights out of us. So I would like to propose a toast on behalf of the bridesmaids and ushers, if we could stand up and propose a toast to Andrew and Lindsay.
Andrew and Lindsay.
Thank you. During my speech. It's not going well. Let's do it quickly.
You've got to give him a prod.
That was awesome.
That's one of the death.
That's probably in the right direction.
I'm a bit red.
I saw that.
You're supposed to see him, you give them new, I can't hear you.
without glasses, I was cheap. I see some of those lovely bows. I said, I'll say 100 quid, 50, 90 quid.
First is cheap. 18th century furniture.
Oh, give it away.
Yeah. You have a house in Ice House, you can have it. You know, why would you go out and pay hundreds of pounds
for money? Exactly. Lovely stuff.
Lovely George and stuff and everything.
It's hard as a rock. Stuff for the audience.
Yeah. Have you been, I tell you what, Dave, have you been watching the historical stuff about the Queen's ancestors?
Aye, some of it.
Oh my God, some of it. Did you watch the Georgian stuff?
Aye.
No, him and his family recently. I didn't know much about it. You know, the Queen's father became king.
Aye.
She was part of the lesser royal, and her mother was called Fat Mary in the 19th century. And she had loads of money, and they went backwards. And they had to sell their stuff off. Because that's the royalty, but the little royalty. And so they had to go to Florence, and she got herself educated. She was told over, she was very embarrassed about her family. She was her mother. And she got herself educated. And that's it. Queen was taught in Italy, and through all the families. And so she, Northern Naples was born in Wales, her name was Daisy. And so the brother was married to the man in her oldest, Edward. But he died, it was a very strong. The dad was
supposed to be. She was,
so she went down to George, and after, you know, after the little day, became George was with it. And he was a right stickler for
go to be discreet.
Don't